was 25 years ago, how many people eat sushi? That time was very selected people. Today, look there, sushi now, like a sandwich. Well, Japanese food is, you know, people think it nowadays, very popular sort of cuisine nowadays, but still, sort of people think it mystery. You know, oh, it's very hard to make a special stock or whatever, called dashi and stuff like that. But nowadays, it can be very easy. And like a store like this, you get just about everything.
Tetsuya Wakuda is Australia's most celebrated chef. His creative combination of Japanese flavours with French techniques has made Tetsuya's one of the world's elite restaurants. His food is based on pure, clean flavours, and one of his favourite ingredients is dashi, the main building block of Japanese cuisine. Dashi is a golden stock made with a combination of dried kelp or kombu.
This is from Hokkaido, it's a northern part of Japan.
And fine shavings of dried smoked bonito fish.
This is shiro dashi. Mm-hmm. It's already made. Basically, this is everything. Traditionally, we don't have chicken stock or veal stock or we don't. Fish stock, which this is it. Soy sauce. Who doesn't know today? Now there's so many variety of soy sauce here. This is some of the larger quantity one, but also this is for tamari. Slightly thicker, good with the sashimi. This is actually the traditional way they made soy sauce. And this is organic.
Tell me, with all the different prices here, do you get what you pay for? Is it like, say, olive oil, like it is worth spending money getting the best?
Yes.
Okay.
Mirin, 20 years ago, mirin have to look for it. Now there's even supermarket sales. So everyone knows sushi, right? Well, to make a sushi, rice, which is rice vinegar, salt, sugar. And already, either this is already made ones, and also this is also a little bit of dashi in it. So it should give you tastiness. Also, rice vinegar make very nice dressing. Exactly like a French dressing, instead of wine vinegar, but the rice vinegar is actually, acidity is much more softer. Sake, which is cooking sake.
So you don't need to get it at a bottle store?
When you cook it, you don't use $100 bottle of sake. No, I don't think so.
No.
This is the konnyaku. It's made from potato starch. And exactly the same way we make a pasta. Very nice. And you never, like a very sort of like nice texture to it.
Chewy a little bit.
Chewy a little bit. Uh-huh. And then zero calorie.
Really?
Zero.
Zero?
Zero calorie. And I really like it. Okay, another thing is nori. Can you see the difference of price? $7.80, $30.05. Quality, grade of the nori. It's color slightly hard to see, but yeah. Different. Darker one.
So the more expensive is darker?
Yes, and also the much more aromatic. But also very commonly, almost every Japanese household has the another seaweed, which is the wakame. Which I think everyone knows, like, you know, seaweed salad and so,
yeah.
We must have this. But also when you make a miso soup, which that's what I use.
Mm-hmm. So this reconstitutes straight away?
Straight away.
Tell me exactly what miso is.
Basically, first of all, dark miso and white miso. And compare with, particularly, this is shiro miso, which is white. Shiro means white, the color difference.
Right. Is it all made from beans?
Soybeans. Also, another one. This is from Kyoto area, Saikyo miso, which is actually sweet. And so less salt as well. And you can find them often, misos like this, in an open refrigeration. But this is normally keep in the freezer.
When you have miso in the morning, how do you feel? Like, what is it that...
Something like a very, sort of like, I don't know what it is. Clean in a sense. It's no oil, no nothing. And look, I like olive oil, everything I use in the cooking as well. But in the breakfast, also how I brought up with. So it's natural thing for us. Like some people here, nothing against vegemite. After 25 years, still only thing I cannot eat is vegemite.
Really?
I don't know. What is the attraction then? You know, like for me, like Western people, some people, miso, and vegemite for me, like that.
You can't have Japanese food without dashi. Yeah. We start with dashi. Yeah.
Yuki Totsuka works as a vet and loves cooking Japanese food using many age-old techniques. She makes her dashi from scratch.
This is the piece of kombu. They come in long strips, so you only need about a 10 centimetre square, so cut it and snip a few extra bits in to let the flavour all come through. And then you soak it in water. That's one I put in about half an hour ago, and it all goes back to its original size. Mm-hmm. Then we boil that away, probably on sort of medium heat. So when you start seeing little bubbles come up from the side of the kombu, then that's when it's ready for you to take the kombu out. Now, this is the bonito, so it's a piece of the fish that's been boiled and smoked and dried.
Sort of looks like a prosciutto almost.
Almost, yeah. And you have this really nice shiny meat inside. And this is the special shaving tool. Careful with your fingers, but that's how you do it. And then you end up with the flakes in at the bottom. And then you put the bonito flakes in.
So is that like one cup of bonito flakes?
Oh, say two big handfuls. And the heat back on. Just sort of when you start seeing the little bubbles. And then we'll turn it off. And then just let it sit and wait till it goes, or all the flakes sink to the bottom of the pan. And then we just strain it through. Yeah, that's it.
That's beautiful.
That's the basic stock. General rule of miso is the darker the colour of the miso, the sort of stronger and sharper the flavour, and lighter it is, sweeter and milder. So that's sort of halfway. There's about a litre of stock in here. It's probably plenty of miso. So you start off with a small amount, and what you do, you just melt the miso in nice and easy. And there you go, that stock turned into miso soup.
Any seasonal vegetable can be added to make a hearty soup. Yuki's favourite additions are wakame and tofu.
We just have to heat it through.
Wow.
It's very hot.
That is really good.
The essence of Japanese food is its focus on the purity and quality of the ingredients and the appreciation of food in its natural state. Seasonal food is celebrated and the first fruit or vegetable of the season is prized. Chef Kimitata Azuma has dedicated 35 years to honing his craft and creating perfection. From a perfectly peeled tomato filled with tuna, to the new season's persimmon, its flesh diced and mixed with a tofu-based dressing.
So it's a beautiful creamy dressing.
Yes. Very healthy.
Ah, yes, that's important, isn't it? Yeah.
Lemons with julienne snow peas and flying fish roe. Fillets of fish and its crunchy bones fried to golden perfection. Wagyu-wrapped asparagus. Oysters with ponzu dressing and a few delicate salmon roe. A sliver of eggplant topped with miso dressing. The presentation of this beautiful series of tastes is crucial. The right bowl or plate is as important as the flavour, and the arrangement of the food is guided by the artistic concept of negative space. The empty areas help to highlight the exquisite beauty of the food.
That is amazing. It's too beautiful to eat.
Thank you so much.
It's astounding how far sushi has come since it first arrived in Australia. Japanese school children used to be asked why they were eating rice wrapped in carbon paper. Now nori-wrapped sushi is in sandwich shops and school canteens. But really good sushi is still an art form.
Shinji Tani is a sushi master with 20 years' experience in London, New York and Sydney. As well as skill, he says speed is crucial, as even the warmth of his hand can change the flavour of sushi.
I didn't even see the fish in the other hand. It's like a magician. Now, is it true that all the rice grains should point in the same direction?
No way. Who said that?
So that's one of the myths, is it?
No, it's
you couldn't do it.
If I do this, like this.
Yeah. You cook the rice again.
Right.
Japanese customers, when they come, what are they looking for from the sushi master?
To look at the chef. Maybe skill, knife skill.
Knife skill.
Yeah, and how fast and how clean. Mm.
You're open to the customers, so everyone sees you.
Yeah.
So, you know, you put on a performance, don't you?
My job. I have to make a living.
So give me the don'ts with sushi. Tell me.
Most of the Western people always, this, for example, soy sauce, like this.
Yeah.
Right? And of course, rice, sucking a soy sauce a lot. Mm-mm. So more almost soy sauce taste. Because Western people like a strong taste.
Mm. Give me the class on how to eat sushi like a Japanese person.
I eat that.
Okay, I'll get, so like just show this. Me. You just did the quick little.
Yeah.
And that's enough? One bite? Mm. Very fresh, very beautiful.
For the past 25 years, Kei Fukui has conducted cooking classes for Japanese expatriates and interested Aussies. Her speciality is the kaiseki banquet, a series of exquisite seasonal dishes that accompany sake. They include a soup, sashimi, grilled chicken or fish, a salad, and rice. And it's the rice that Kei's daughter Masako has learned to make from a young age. She's now a journalist, but still helps her mother with her classes and passes on what she's learned as well.
So tell me about making sushi at home.
Well, the very first thing you have to do is to get the right kind of rice. So this is a short, medium grain rice. It's called koshihikari rice, but it's also marketed as sushi rice. So you wash the rice, wash this quite well, and then we're going to soak it in water and leave for 30 minutes. And then we're going to steam the rice, preferably in a rice cooker, because it comes out nice. This is a wooden bowl, it's not finished, so the rice won't stick as easily. It absorbs some of the moisture so that it's easier to mix the vinegar into the rice.
Mm.
So rice. And this is the rice vinegar, sugar and salt mixture, and you just pour it on. But you've got to pour it on quite evenly. Mm-hmm. You don't want it in one spot. And then we use a cutting action.
So this is just coating it in the...
Yes.
So do you call it sushi vinegar?
Yes, sushi vinegar.
Mm-hmm.
And then just fan the rice and you'll see that it gets quite shiny. And the shininess of the rice is quite important because it's quite a decorative dish. I mean, it looks good. And then we put a wet cloth on it and leave it until it cools a little bit more. You need to wet your hands. This is rice vinegar. You want your hands to be quite wet but not, you know, not drenched. And you want to spread it out without squashing the rice. You want to try and get the rice, most of the rice in the middle, but this side is the side that's, it's a bit like the envelope bit that sticks. So you want to leave about 1 centimetre, 1.5 centimetres blank.
Masako fills the nori with a Japanese vegetable called gourd, which has been cooked in dashi stock. Then soaked shiitake mushrooms, blanched carrots, cucumber, and slices of omelette.
Then we have to wet the end so it'll stick, just like you would lick your envelope. And then, not all the way to the edge, but just leave a little bit of the bamboo rolling mat. Makes it easier. And you want to roll it quite tight here.
Okay, so you're putting pressure.
Quite a lot of pressure. But you want to be gentle as well, firm but gentle. Just like you want your men to be. And then you pull this.
Oh, are you trying to make that square?
Squarish, not square, but squarish. Yeah. And hopefully, it's all stuck together. So we're going to cut this into eight.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So you don't need to dip these in anything?
No dipping in soy sauce.
No other cuisine uses seafood in quite the same way the Japanese do. From seaweed to sea urchins, fish that's dried and flaked, grilled or poached, and eaten raw. Well, tell me, Hideo, you've got 150 knives. It seems like an awful lot. Do most Japanese chefs have that number of knives?
Not really, but fortunately I had such a training.
Hideo Dakura has wielded a knife since the age of 15, growing up in his family's restaurant in Tokyo and bringing his knowledge of both Japanese and French cooking to Australia. Knife technique is the key to taste, he says. And so what is it about a Japanese knife that makes it special?
This knife, this is a sashimi knife called takohiki. One side is very straight, you can say, straight. Other side, carving. We have sort of, rules, especially for the sashimi slice, which meaning is a sharpness. Cutting edges must be sharp. See? Sashimi slice is against vein. Sushi slice is beside the vein. Sort of different rules.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Then create a different taste. Once you eat sashimi into the mouth, you can feel such a sharpness with the taste.
Oh, so a really sharp blade gives you a perfect flavour.
Yes, yes.
And you could tell if a bad knife cut the fish, could you?
Obviously, I can.
Amazing. Tell me what you're going to make today.
Tuna salad.
Tuna salad. Yes. And can anybody make this?
Yes, very easy, yeah. And salt.
White
pepper.
And you like white pepper, do you?
Yeah.
The tuna fillet is seared for about 10 seconds on all sides and sliced. Azuma then makes his own ponzu dressing using vinegar, grapeseed oil, sesame oil, grated onion and white pepper. He then allows the flavours to soak into the fish. Azuma prepares and finally grates daikon radish and grated white onion.
Topping.
So the radish and the onion mix on top?
Yes.
Chopped spring onion?
Yes.
Shiso leaf?
Yes.
He then cuts thin ribbons of beetroot and slices them finely, adding them to the salad. Along with julienne ginger, golden crunchy garlic, and baby celery leaves.
Topping. Yummy.
It is yummy. Wow. That's so fresh. So beautiful. Oh. And so easy. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
So, you think I'm going to make miso soup? No. But saikyoyaki, this is traditionally, it's not like a my creation, nothing. This is 100 years old recipe.
So this is an all-purpose marinade that works with either fish, poultry, red meat?
Beef. We can do that too. This is saikyo miso from Kyoto area. A little bit sweet. And a little bit cooking sake. And still mirroring. Like so, to just soften it.
Is this a colour that you like as well?
Colour and the consistency.
Yeah.
Ginger. Depends again, you taste it, what kind of, you like more ginger? Put it in there. It's no such a thing in a cooking, I believe, has to be this way. Because some people like salty, some people sweeter, and this alternate food suits you. And then you want to eat anyway, so doing it. I like a little bit of garlic into it. Grape seed oil. Okay, next is fish. Get nice fish as possible, of course. Freshest. Pair like this, any trays. Okay. And now, fresh side.
Flesh side down.
Down, just like that. Like so.
Tetsuya leaves the perch to marinate overnight and scrapes the excess off the next day.
Can you see the difference of colour?
It is, yeah. It's got a pale sort of yellow colour. So texture looks different too.
Yes. Then move to the oven, grilled, until skin just brown. Okay, done. This is actually ginger. We pickled them. Sea perch, saikyuraki.
That is absolutely delicious.
One of the more complicated culinary arts of Japan is noodle making. Soba noodles are made from freshly milled buckwheat. Mixing, rolling, and hand cutting them takes many years to master. Devotees say the clean, pure taste and chewy texture is totally addictive.
There's a real noodle culture in Japan that's luckily spreading to Australia, with small shops specialising in just one type of noodles. Here it's ramen noodles, which originated in China. So what makes really good ramen, Ria?
Soup is very important. This is chicken soup, and this is pork soup.
Yeah. It looks really rich and full of flavour.
Yeah, this one takes about 15 hours.
15 hours?
Yes. And this one, 4-6 hours.
Wow.
Yeah.
So the number one thing that makes people your regulars is the stock,
yeah,
the soup. So tell me the best way to eat ramen noodles, Japanese style.
You have to eat fast.
Yeah.
And quick, because the noodles getting soggy.
And it's okay to slurp?
Yeah.
Yeah? So you can make noise?
Yeah, you have to make noise. So just put in nori inside.
Ah.
And soak in the soup.
Ah, okay. Get noisy.
This is good. Not enough. Not enough sounds.